Nice.
Yes, I am.
Okay. Hello, everybody. Hello. Thank you for being here. I'm very excited. A friend of mine that I met a long time ago is here, Dr. Brenda Dixon Gottschild. She's a goddess. How many people read the book or reading the book? Have the book? Yeah, good.
Good.
We met doing an American College Dance Festival.
That's
we were
right.
Adjudicators, along with the late, great Fernando Bajones. And we clicked immediately, and we love Fernando, but we were seeing a lot of experimental college work. Do you remember this?
Yes.
And I think Mr. Bajones didn't know what was coming at. But it was a wonderful meeting. And Brenda was working on her book, The Black Dancing Body, at
right.
the time. And
yeah.
I was so honored that she said, could we do a few interviews? And we got to talk. I'm very grateful to Brenda. This is very special. You all are so lucky. It's okay to take notes.
Please take notes. As they say, copious notes.
Copious notes. Phones off, throw it away, unless you're taking notes on the phone. But without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Brenda Dixon Gottschild.
Thank you. Thank you so much, and indeed, I do encourage you to turn off your phones and use, and I have to do this, you will be on my Facebook page. Thank you so much, and just to be present with me, with us, with the room, with the moment, I'd like to first of all, acknowledge that indeed black dance matters, black lives matter, Black History Month matters, and here we are. And I'd like to open this presentation with an Africanist process, which is a libation. And I'm going to pour this libation and dedicate this presentation to two of my aesthetic mothers, Catherine Dunham, who brought the dances of Haiti to African America, and Pearl Primus, who taught African Americans the dances of Nigeria. These two goddesses taught us our history in order that we might envision our future. Say with me, if you will, when I pour, the word Ashe, which is the same as Om, Amen, and so be it. Ashe. I'm trying to get close, make contact with your warmth, body, your aura, body, your Kirlian energy field, body. Bodies, bodies, bodies. Those lines are spoken to me by my husband, Helmut Gottschild, in a movement theater piece we created together titled Tongue, Smell, Color. In it, as an African-American woman and a German man, we explore issues of nationality, gender, guilt, memory, and race, sometimes zeroing in on the white male fixation and obsession with the black female body. In that scene titled Tongue, Touch, Skin, Memories, as Helmut approaches and pursues me, he says those lines, I'm trying to get close, make contact with your blah, 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 blah. I tell him he's trespassing, that those astral bodies that he's speaking of are a dancer's imagery. He takes offense, says those bodies are real, exist, can be sensed, and that we all have many bodies that are in constant flux. For some reason, that statement sends me into a tailspin of memories. Body memories. Black body memories. Black female body memories. Black enslaved female body memories. And as though I'm in a trance, I say that word. Memory. Memory. Until he cuts me off. Memories. Yes, indeed. Memories. The body remembers. The body speaks. The body remembers. The body tells us what is valued in the culture. Bodies are mirrors that absorb, remember, and reflect society's politics, art, religion, aesthetics, hopes, fears, strengths, failings, both the officially sanctioned versions and the sub rosa closeted taboos. Bodies are barometers measuring the pulse of society. And I'm here with you today to celebrate the body, the black dancing body, as a measure of culture that bridges divisions and blurs boundaries. Let me give you a little bit of a context with this. I know that we all know that dance is as old as humankind, and that there are many kinds and forms of dance, and that dance has served many different functions in different eras. For example, in African and African-American cultures, and I use the term Africanist to embrace the two. So in Africanist cultures, dance is an integral part of religious practice. And the deities present themselves to the community through the dancing bodies of the religious devotee who dances when and as the spirit moves her. But on the other hand, in many traditional Europeanist Christian sects, the dancing body is a no-no and regarded as a vehicle that leads to evil rather than enlightenment. That's just one example of what it means for us to think about the dancing body as a measure. Oops, I didn't put that up. Oh dear. There we go. To think about the dancing body as a measure of culture. And that, of course, is the title of my presentation. Sorry. Researching Performance, the Black Dancing Body as a Measure of Culture. So that kind of difference between an Africanist religious perspective and a Europeanist religious perspective is one example of what it means for us to think about the dancing body as a measure of culture that points out what is valued or repressed in a given society. For the moment, excuse me, I also want us to think about dance as an embodied language. As ballerina Alessandra Ferri said in a dance magazine article years ago, and I quote, you don't just use your body, but you go through your body to talk. But all too often, those people concerned with the language of words give short shrift to the language of movement. But the language of movement speaks to us as profoundly as words, although through different means and layers of experience. Now, inside each verbal language, we know there are dialects, jargons, colloquialisms, neologisms, and so on. How does a spoken language grow and change? Well, frequently by borrowing elements from other languages in, and this is my neologism, in what I'm calling either transformational linguistics or direct appropriation. And I'll give an example of both. Transformational linguistics. Helmut and I travel a lot between Berlin and Philly. And we notice, of course, through the years, more and more English, American English words in the German language. So the German slang word for a cell phone is handy. And of course, you do hold it in your hand, and it is handy. Transformational linguistics. Another example, those, I don't see anybody wearing them here, but those very small knapsacks that you can wear on the back or the front of your body, the little ones, they call them body bags. Transformational linguistics. And on the other hand, some direct appropriations as well. A couple of examples. German kids, of course, are very cool. And they know about chillin', and if you're not careful, they may diss you. So, transformational linguistics or direct appropriations. Why do I tell you all this? Because the same thing happens in movement. Like the spoken word, dance comes in many languages, and they too receive impulses and infusions from other languages. A good example, and one of my focal points, is the appropriation of Africanisms in so-called white dance. But that's where we enter the realm of the politics of dance and culture. Europeanist body languages and Africanist body languages have been speaking with one another ever since they first met and clashed centuries ago. But they are different languages. To illustrate this point, here's a quote from my first book, Digging the Africanist Presence in American Performance. I've taken a page from the book and pasted it in here. And I will demonstrate while reading. You will understand that I will be 75 in October, so my turnout, thank you, my turnout is a little bit challenged. In traditional European dance aesthetics, the torso must be held upright for correct classic form. The erect spine is the center, the hierarchical ruler from which all movement is generated. It functions as a single unit. The straight, uninflected torso indicates elegance or royalty and acts as the absolute monarch, dominating the dancing body. This vertically aligned spine is the first principle of Europeanist dance, with arm and leg movements emanating from and returning to it. The ballet canon is organized around this principle. In fact, this structural principle is a microcosm of the post-Renaissance colonialist worldview. Like the straight-centered spine of its dancing body, Europe posited itself as the center of the world, with everything else controlled and defined by it. Think, if you will, where ballet technique originated, the court of Louis XIV, le roi soleil, l'état, c'est moi, the world is me. Africanist dance idioms show a democratic equality of body parts. The spine is just one of many possible movement centers, and it rarely remains static. The Africanist dancing body is polycentric. One part of the body is played against another, and movements may simultaneously originate from more than one focal point. The head and the pelvis, for example. It is polyrhythmic, which I cannot demonstrate. Different body parts moving to two or more rhythms simultaneously. As assessed by Africanist aesthetic criteria, the Europeanist dancing body is rigid, aloof, cold, and one-dimensional. By Europeanist standards, the Africanist dancing body is vulgar, comic, uncontrolled, undisciplined, and most of all, promiscuous. Clearly, folks, there is a translation problem going on here. Nevertheless, and despite different vocabularies, the reason for dancing is like the reason for dreaming. Through dance or dreams, we access ideas and metaphors that can't be perceived in any other way. In fact, dance is a literature that is illegible in literal translation. And who am I in all this? I'm a performing researcher researching performance. Writing is my choreography for the page. The body is my medium, and I recognize that the body, the dancing body, the black dancing body, thinks, speaks, writes its signature across world history, whether we know it or not, whether we recognize it or not. Dance has many layers to be uncovered in researching, and this is maybe why sometimes I feel like I'm a detective, sniffing out clues, acting on hunches. I follow cultural inklings, like the somatic trail I blazed about Africanisms in the Americanization of ballet. Sometimes the work can be like E.L. Doctorow's quip on writing novels. Has anyone here read any of E.L. Doctorow's work? Good, okay, Ragtime, etc. Anyway, these are authors that you might be interested in knowing. Anyway, Doctorow said that writing novels is like night driving. You see as far as your headlights will let you, but you can make the whole trip that way. And Buddhist writer Natalie Goldberg advises that you, quote, write from your obsessions. They're going to run your life anyway, so why not harness them? Well, I'm an artist, writing about art, writing into history two marginalized legacies that are my obsession and my passion, dance itself and Africanisms in dance. As a cultural historian, I use a creolized approach to interrogate dance as history, biography, sociology, anthropology, philology, philosophy, politics, religion. In doing my job, I observe, listen, read, interpret, surmise, analyze, and compare, and too often find myself confronted by inequalities, if not injustices. In this first book, Digging the... Oh, it doesn't stay up there, Donald. How come it doesn't stay up? Okay. No, there we go. Okay. In Digging the Africanist Presence, I started out by asking questions of American ballet that, like all ballet, was regarded as classically European. That means white. Right? But I was picking up a different scent. George Balanchine, a Russian choreographer who emigrated to the USA in the 1930s, joined up with entrepreneur Lincoln Kirstein to form the Ballet Society in 1946, which in 1948 became the New York City Ballet. He's been credited with the Americanization of ballet. Well, if that's the case, I asked, what makes his ballets so especially American? I began to sniff an Africanist trail. In order to verify it, though, I had to step back and see what was behind the trees. What were the clues, the hidden clues? Who were the players, the real players? I went back to what was right in front of my nose, namely contemporary culture and lifestyles. And I'm going to show you some of that evidence. And this is a really quick and broad look-see. Many of the images that you're going to see are from the early 1990s, before many of you were born. But that's when I began my research for the first book, Digging the Africanist Presence, and when what is known as the culture wars and revising the canon were at their height. But I just want to mention, even though these are 25 plus years ago visuals, this appropriation and sometimes outright stealing of Africanist premises and properties continues to this day. Not only in pop culture and Miley Cyrus or who have you, but also in every avenue of American aesthetic endeavor. So I'm going to show you this broad sweep, beginning first for evidence of Africanist presences as the semiotics of fashion and popular culture. And if you need to look up the word semiotic, be sure you do. Okay? So what's the message here? First, how Africanisms, can you see over there? Okay, how Africanisms appear as an exotic commodity in the mainstream beauty market. Can people identify the woman on your left? Yes?
Cicely Tyson.
Cicely Tyson, thank you. And can somebody identify the woman on your right? Somebody else. Yes, Bo Derek. Okay, Cicely Tyson and Bo Derek. Okay, my comment with this one is, guess whose braids came first? Okay, not to lay it on poor Bo too much, but interestingly enough, these are two magazine covers. Playboy over here, it's March 1980, and the Jet magazine cover is from 1978. I think as somatic people, you can see the relationship in the positioning, in the whole body language, in the costume, obviously. John Derrick, who was a second class, a grade B Hollywood actor, as was his wife, Bo, he created the concept of Bo and 10, the concept of 10. And all I can say in this slide, in these couplings, is John Derrick was definitely doing his research. And here, an L model, L magazine, with an extremely overarched spine, and again, a hairdo in the early 90s when white women were beveling their hair so it looked as though they had taken out braids. And this goes back then, if you think about the early 1970s, the white women with curled hair, which was to kind of look like the Afro, but then black women began to curl their hair in something called the Jerry Curl. So there's all of this kind of recursive stuff that goes on, but interesting to see the root of Africanisms in these kinds of recursions. So the L model with overarched spine, and I go, what's the message here? A body carriage so popular in the contemporary high fashion and entertainment industry, obsessed with being bootylicious, and Here, this emphasizes, of course, the little bit of butt that she does have by this arching of the spine. But what I find that's so interesting is that whole booty culture is unduly characterized as an Africanist posture to be corrected in the dance world, where black dancers are told, or at least were, to tuck it in. Interesting, isn't it, that so-called black postures must be either exaggerated or modified when black bodies enter the white world? Vanity Fair advertisement. Notice the African-inspired head and neckwear, things that we don't even think about necessarily. Lollapalooza hair wrapping. Again, these were large, the way people would get together for a Grateful Dead marathon. These were large rock concert marathons. And so one of the side booths here is hair wrapping. Another example of how white youth culture so readily adopts Africanisms as its own. No questions, no problems. But they probably are unaware of its origins. Again, very much 1980s, 1990s, white athletes hand jiving. How often we would see back then high and low fives, buttocks bumping, and other Africanist-inspired expressive movements in professional sports. And I'm sure everybody recognizes the guy on your left. Somebody? Elvis. Anybody recognize the guy on your right? Ah. One of Elvis's true inspirations, Jackie Wilson. Okay, Google Jackie Wilson and hear some great music. Okay, what's the message here? The age-old story of white musicians covering the look and sound of black music. Okay, this one is a little story in and of itself. This slide and the one that comes after it. And I'm calling that those two, four couples, two slides, from insult to fashion statement. So, on your left, the baggies on the street were taken from the oversized overalls of prison inmates, most of whom we know are black. They were given bulky clothes that didn't fit to humiliate them. But what the inmates did, they took that lemon and made lemonade. They made a fashion statement of it. And their brothers or sons or nephews in black neighborhoods took it up as a style. And then white youth picked up the style. And then at the bottom here, it's a fashion statement in the 1990s before women were wearing such tight things. Remember, they had our stuff hanging off our shoulders. Comme les garçons fashion house had this baggy style. And up there, I think probably most of you are too young to recognize who they are. It's Criss Cross, right, who were wearing their clothes baggy and backwards. Right? So to me, all of this, these two slides, represent American culture's unconscious homage to black men in prison. And since we are talking about languages, just let us look at how much African-American signifying has affected our speech and consequently our way of seeing the world. Like, if I say to you, that headdress, honey, is sick. What do I mean? It's nice, good. It's cool, it's nice, it's good, it's cool. And of course, if I say, that's cool, you know, or I'm chilling, it doesn't mean that I need my jacket. And if I go, ow, you know that I am not in pain. So, rather than classical Europeanist linear logic of cause, effect, and resolution, we have irony, paradox, double entendre, indeed radical juxtaposition as basic premises of the Africanist aesthetic. And where do we find them? We find them every place in our culture for all of us. Elsewhere in Digging the Africanist Presence, I discuss subtle Africanist resonances in other areas that have been considered exclusively white terrain. For example, to illustrate the widespread, though unconscious, cultural adoption of deep structure Africanist attitudes, you understand, not content, but attitudes, I discuss contact improvisation. This is a little tricky, so please do try to follow. And take your notes. Like African American movements as diverse as the early blues, jazz, and civil rights grassroots communities, the contact community began as a subculture that thrived in spite of and as an antidote to establishment modern dance. I've made this equation to illustrate the relationship. And what this means is that contact's response to modern dance unconsciously parallels and is predicated upon the civil rights movement's response to the American status quo. Let's leave that up for a second. In an example of perhaps inadvertent borrowing, even the contact improviser's jam takes its name from anybody? Jazz, okay. Takes its name from the jazz musician's word for group improvisation. Like an old-fashioned African-American revival meeting, these jams see contactors from far and wide converge to hold a marathon. And in contact, as in its jazz paradigm, participants improvise, allowing their creations to be inflected and modified by what the others are doing. And what's the message here? What's the precedent for wearing sunglasses while performing in a dark interior space? Anybody? Okay, you probably know it. This too is part of the jazz aesthetic, okay? So in late 1940s and early 1950s, Dizzy Gillespie, Charlie Parker, Miles Davis, kind of as a reaction to the big band hot era of the swing era, Duke Ellington and Jimmy Lunsford and Louis Armstrong, those kind of musicians that like were going out to the audience, they pulled in a cool format, wearing a bob cap, maybe smoking a joint, playing to themselves with the audience having to come to them, and often putting those sunglasses on to hide those red eyes. So, excuse me. And by the way, does anybody recognize him? Yes, okay. I call him the father of contact improv. This again reminds us of the way one language, whether by transformational linguistics or direct appropriation, infiltrates another. We can say that without the jazz aesthetic, contact improvisation could not have come about. the Africanist presence was such a driving force in the foundations of modern dance that its pervasiveness may partly account for its neglect. But then I also feel that some of the neglect was not necessarily so benign. This is from Lewis Horst's book, Modern Dance Forms, which many years ago used to be a staple in dance departments. And so Horst has already made the correlation between this sculpture from Gabon, a painting by Picasso, Grande Danseuse, and Martha Graham in her woolen period in the 1930s I can't see the name of the dance here. But interestingly enough, Horst characterizes this kind of work as archaic, never says anything about African. Here is Graham again, 1935, Satiric Festival. And here she is disrupting everything that I tried to demonstrate about the Europeanist ballet dancing body. So her legs are turned in, the back is arched, the arms are angular instead of the alignment of the traditional Europeanist body. Iris Mabry, another mid-20th century dancer in a dance called Bird Spell. And this one is interesting. This one looks to me very much like a piece of African art. And of course, it's not that Graham and Mabry and other dancers were taking this specifically from Africa. There was this incredible nexus between modern dance and modern art. So dancers doing what Picasso, Braque, Matisse, Léger, and legions more had laid out for them. So it's their secondhand appropriation, if you will. So I think I leave that on for a minute and just get to ballet for a moment. What are some of these references in ballet? Africanist references. So instead of what I had shown you, pelvic and chest, articulation and displacement, instead of vertical alignment, leg kicks, instead of carefully placed battements, angular arms, instead of the traditional fluid porte-bras of Europeanist ballet, are Africanist motifs that are imported into ballet. Anyone who's interested, all of this is analyzed in detail in chapter 5 of Digging the Africanist Presence. But as I say there, and I repeat it, even more significant than these motifs is the underlying speed, vitality, energy, coolness, the deep structure or subtext of a jazz aesthetic that made all the difference in giving ballet an American quality. But naming and language are of utmost importance. These qualities are not only American, they are African-American. You know, we need to pay closer attention to the language of words that we select to describe the language of movement. Yes, set off the alarms. So, before there was a New York City ballet, Mr. Balanchine, and I'm assuming everybody recognizes Mr. Balanchine. Does everybody recognize this woman? Yes? Miss Dunham, thank you. Okay. Before there was a New York City ballet, Mr. B cut his eye teeth on Broadway musicals, including co-choreographing with Catherine Dunham, Cabin in the Sky in 1940. And here he is horsing around with the cast of Cabin in the Sky in what, if I were a psychologist, would talk about as an extremely sexualized trajectory aimed directly at Ms. Dunham. Anyway, he choreographed her, with Ms. Dunham on Cabin in the Sky. He also choreographed a series of Broadway musicals, I Married an Angel, On Your Toes, The Boys from Syracuse, working with people like the Nicholas Brothers. He worked with Josephine Baker, even put her on point to see what that would be like. So he was immersed in what it meant to come to America and be in the world of black endeavor. He had wanted, as some of you know, to start first a school with four black dancers, four white dancers, and how they would influence each other. So we'll, it's all talked about more in the book. So this is interesting. Here is Mr. Balanchine with one of his principals, Violette Verdi, and I would say that here he is showing her some jazz. So his body is in the decidedly Africanist pose. Legs turned in, feet turned in, hips off center, gaze down in what is called the mask of the cool, and hands in this angular way. What's interesting with Miss Verdi is that she is still centered in the position that she has internalized as correct. And here, oh, I'm sorry, they're decapitated, but it's okay because you need to see it. Here is Mr. Balanchine with Mr. Arthur Mitchell. And here, I would say it's the reverse. It is as though Mr. Mitchell is teaching Mr. Balanchine some jazz. And you have enough of the body for me to ask you the question, why would I say that in this one? You're so good, but go ahead. The torsion, yes, good. And what else about Miss? That's very good. What else about Mr. Mitchell's body besides the torque, the torsion? The butt. The butt. Yeah. Who said this? There you go. Okay. That his hip is very much more asymmetrical. He's much more in a get down pose, if you would, if you will. Now, what is interesting, of course, is that dancers, this is the choreographer, this is the dancer. But as any of you who are choreographing know, when there is something very interesting that one of your dancers does, you incorporate it into your work. Okay, stealing? No. Appropriation? Yes. And I also want to mention something very interesting about Mr. Mitchell, the nexus between dance and society. Mr. Mitchell leaves ABT and begins the Dance Theater of Harlem in 1968 as a response to the assassination of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. At that point, he felt, as many of us feel right now in the Black Dance Matter, in the Black Lives Matter movement, he felt, I've got to do something for my community. He began Dance Theater of Harlem. According to Mitchell, Balanchine described his ideal ballerina as possessing a short torso, long arms, and long legs, a designation that fit to a T the censured profile of many black dancing bodies, including my own. But what is interesting is by stating this preference and following it through with his artistic choices, Balanchine unconsciously shifted the balance of the ideal ballet body toward the black side, but not using black dancers, finding these body proportions and alignments in white ballerinas. And just to show you a little bit that graphically illustrates the difference, here is Margot Fonteyn, beautiful principal with the Royal Ballet, and illustrating the classical European ballet body, the modest tutu'd body, emphasizing what? Torso length, which I never had, I wanted that. Emphasizing torso length and totally hiding the buttocks and the hips, and thus also shortening the line of the legs, as opposed to something again from Dance Magazine years ago, Princeton Ballet. And this then is very much like Mitchell's description, all arms and legs. So this then is the post-Balanchinian American dancing, American ballet body. Okay, and it's not as though I'm, throwing shade on Balanchine. I feel like instead I'm enlightening Balanchine's work. And beyond the Balanchine example, and in a larger sense, my work aims to break down barriers between so-called art and so-called entertainment, between high and low, between black and white, if you will. Indeed, my work is concerned with dance, with history, and with affecting social justice. And that final area, affecting social justice, is the one that centers and grounds my thinking professionally and personally. I aim to perform corrective surgery on the historical record. So it seems that for many people, I'm skipping through talking about my second book just to save time. This is Waltzing in the Dark, African American Vaudeville and Race Politics in the Swing Era. This was the early version of this, Sean, was my dissertation at NYU. And Richard Schechner was my dissertation advisor. Really interesting study if you're interested in the swing era, if you're interested in the pervasive presence of racial premises and properties in our nation. And of course, people doing ballet way back then, doing Ted Shawn type of dancing. And then again, the racism of places like cotton clubs and plantation clubs. Anyway, to move to my third book, The Black Dancing Body, A Geography from Kuhn to Kuhl, it is a map of American history as told through the body, a map that predicates black history and dance history as central to the formation of American culture and American identity. My basic premise is that race and body types are not biological imperatives, but social constructs, and cultural stereotypes or conveniences for the purpose of separation and categorization and discrimination, segregation, racism. I take a long, detailed look at the sometimes loved, sometimes hated attributes of black dancing bodies, with chapters named for and devoted to feet, buttocks, hair, skin color, and finally soul and spirit, which I discuss as embodied animate attributes, as American, African-American cultural components that belong to whites as much as Beethoven and ballet belong to blacks. I interviewed 24 dance practitioners, two of whom are in the room, Wendy Perrin and Sean Curran. Dancers, choreographers, writers, a dance librarian, black, white, and brown, male and female, young and old, working in tap, ballet, modern, postmodern, hip-hop, Broadway, and African genres. I'm going to show you some slides. These are not the slides that are in, these are not the visuals that are in the book, but these were some of my inspiration for the book. Jim Crow, and again, going back to early stealing and appropriation that was not recognized at all. It was as though what he was doing was worth nothing until Thomas Daddy Rice gave it a white veneer. Okay, this one, and that's lately I put up. Paraded through 19th century Europe as an exotic oddity, known as the Hottentot Venus, facetiously, of course, Sarah Bartman's body set the stage for the perception of the black female body to this very day in a contested love-hate relationship, as seen, for example, in the Europeanist adoption of the bustle and in our dear Miss Kardashian's total exposure. What's the message there? Her body can be understood as the battlefield where the war between white self and black other was waged. As a researcher, and you can look up tons of information on the Hottentot Venus, Sarah Bartman, Google it, wonderful papers, etc. And one researcher, Yvette Abrahams, pointed out in an article titled Images of Sarah Bartman, and I'm paraphrasing Abrahams, in 19th century British freak shows, white freaks were exhibited as oddities, exceptions to the rule, while blacks like Bartman were presented as typical of their race. The Bartman rendering you are seeing, therefore, must be understood as more a figment of the European imaginary than a scientific, reliable, historical record. It's an example of implicit bias, okay? In other words, you see what you want to see. You see through the eyes of your culture's norms and stereotypes. Okay, I will let that rest. And I'll just put up my wonderful slide of La Baquère. I love this, making fun of her image, I like to say. And this was another inspiration for the black dancing body. Meredith Monk is a postmodern composer, vocalist, and choreographer who you all know about. At the end of our interview for the Black Dancing Body, I asked Meredith if there was anything that she'd like to add. And here's what she said. Well, my gratitude that somehow I've been allowed to have this African-American experience as part of my life and culture. I start really becoming aware of it when I'm in Europe and Europeans are trying to rock and roll dance and it's kind of pathetic. And then you realize how much of America is black culture, that we've had the privilege of having this as part of what we've grown up with. I feel that so much when I'm away, out of America, and how actually the dominant culture has been the black culture on a certain level in terms of what's going out to the world. What people are getting from America is black culture. Even though I'm white, I feel like I have that in my body. I have that loose thing in my body. But then I have to say this with total gratitude and awareness. Not that I take this for granted, that I take this with great gratitude. Close quote. Would that every European and European American felt that way. Okay, just about through, just to say a word or two about, those were all inspirations, a word or two about the latest book, Joan Myers Brown and the Audacious Hope of the Black Ballerina. I used Joan Myers Brown's career as the fulcrum to leverage a discussion of the interplay between performance, cultural formation, and race politics, as demonstrated by the development of her dance community that burst beyond the parameters of Black Philadelphia. And we have Donald Shorter to witness for that. Donald trained with Danko. And burst beyond Philadelphia, burst beyond regional borders to reach national and international renown. Philadelphia's dance history is exceptionally rich and speaks to larger issues in American life, issues of aesthetics, identity, community, allowing us to more fully understand what I began with, dance as a valid measure of culture. So, dear people, where have I taken you on this journey of dance and race? And where does this leave you? There's a Buddhist saying, what the mind doesn't know, the eye cannot see. That may help explain white America's blind spot about its Africanist heritage. What the mind doesn't know, the eye cannot see. I've tried in this presentation to give you some recent histories, but these histories are not in the past. They're not over, they're not done with. Cultural appropriation continues and credit is not given where credit is due. Cultural appropriation, in fact, is booming so that hip hop and big butts are now owned by Kardashian, Eminem, Macklemore. But when black people owned these properties, they were considered ghetto or ratchet or trifling. And black pop icons like Jay-Z don't even cringe when their white pals like Gwyneth Paltrow use the N-word. And outright discrimination continues, with qualified black folks shut out of decent jobs, education, and housing, and shut into prisons. And outright racist violence and murder continues. New Orleans, Ferguson, Cleveland, Queens, Tampa, Orlando, and on and on and on and on. So I leave you with a final question. Where will you stand wherever you are? And what will you do? Ashe. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. We have some time. I'm not sure how much, but if you have issues or questions or comments, if there's something you didn't understand, I can try to explain it a little more deeply.
Can you turn on this middle bank of lights?
Yes, yeah, that would be good. Yeah. Wendy.
This isn't your main point, but I thought it was interesting that contact improvisation and the jam sessions and the dark classes and all that stuff.
Yes.
But at Justin Dance Theater, there's a lot of touching and falling.
Yes.
Specifically with Carolee Schneemann. And I think Carolee actually used the term violent contact. And didn't you dance with Carolee?
I danced with her, yes.
So I wonder why you would.
Not necessarily violent contact. I worked with her in London at a big thing at the Roundhouse. And again, though, this sense of, you know, as I was saying to Liz, coming into this building, me who had lived at 99 Avenue B in the 1960s and stuff, there was a community in New York, people like Carolee, Yvonne Rainer, just bunches of other people living down here and very much connecting with the jazz aesthetic. I mean, Archie Shepp lived in the same, up the street from me. You know, Leroy Jones, who then became Amiri Baraka, was around the corner. And at that point, he was married to his Jewish wife, whose name, unfortunately, I forget. Say it again? Hetty? Maybe that was her name, yeah. But that there was this kind, so certainly, and I'm not sure that this is what you're asking, Wendy, but there was this sense of merging of black and white communities around the 60s, wherein they were certainly, again, as I said, this jazz aesthetic being a an antidote to you know, or contact aesthetic being an antidote to being a modern dancer, the way the civil rights era was an antidote to, you know, the business as usual of the American government, which we're back into right now. So, I mean, I see that there was this influence back and forth. And when I was working with her, we didn't say anything about violent contact, but we did things like that, actually. It was called Catch and Fall, and it was wonderful. I've used that a lot. Anybody want to try it with me? Okay, all right. So just that we would come toward each other and catch, okay, and then very slowly melt. And I can't go down because of my knees. Thank you. Oh, how lovely to be carried. So one of the things we did, thank you, was catch and fall. And we did these things in, so yeah, that would be. Okay, well, again, the coming out of the same generation. Right. And again, I feel very much a jazz aesthetic there. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, exactly, right. And she, Yvonne, wrote a wonderful thing for my latest book. And we were in, Yvonne did a real understanding of that kind of contact in New York. Her film Privilege, which deals a lot with the black and white interactions on the Lower East Side then. Yeah. Ronald, and then, I'm sorry, Donald, and then.
First of all, thank you so much for all of you that you brought today and all your wealth of knowledge and experience and research.
Thank you.
I felt really grateful to just be in the room with you and take in everything and to be able to meet you. And I really appreciated and connected with your Philodenko t-shirt. And I'm so glad that I was able to find out that you have written this book on Joe Myers Brown.
Yes.
And Philodenko, I started training there when I was like 21. I didn't start dancing until I was 19.
Oh,
and
really?
I'm so grateful that that is an institution. And that was the institution that I got to find out about dance as related to, and I don't necessarily, I think I identified it as black dance.
Good.
I saw it as a place where I could have discoveries about being a dancer.
Yes.
But it wasn't until later, because I had danced for black people pretty much a while after that. And when I got out of dance and went into commercial theater, that's when I started getting into more of a white mainstream form. And it was then that I realized how lucky I was to be able to be taught by masters who were black. So there was already this self-identification that I was having.
Yes.
There was this transmission of information that I was getting about my own self as it was rooted in my historical context that I didn't know.
There you go.
So being able to work with people like Milton Myers and Mary Hinkson and Dolores Brown.
Yes.
And Rennie Harris and Ronald K. Brown and
all of them are interviewed in the book.
And to be able to just be there and to see black people like producing dance, lighting dance, making dance, studying dance.
Right.
That information was so valid, I think, to myself, and it wasn't something that I came in to knowing how powerful that was. And I saw Philodenko now as an institution where we all were, and then we take that and we branch out
all of
who we have become there till now. So thank you for allowing me to be able to get a little bit of insight into the book so I can do research later.
Thank you so much, Donald. And I hope people kind of got a sense of what Donald was saying and about this incredible what he didn't know was happening for him, this kind of unconscious, deep acquisition of Salavasana, I'm thinking of like the second chakra, of sense of self, the deep acquisition of sense of self without it having to be said that way. And because he was surrounded by people with all of this knowledge, nobody was saying, oh, you can't do this, or, and Ms. Joan, none of them are easy on you. None of them are easy, but they are not telling you that you don't belong there. And that is something that so many people of color miss in our culture. Thanks, Donald. Yes. Okay, and then you, okay? And I hope I didn't miss anything.
Sue says that the love that time passed, you know, I mean, let's see, it's wonderful. A lecture that you've given, but I could remember that in the early days of Alan Nikla, who was the father of Mahjong Media, we had in our school in Henry Frank on the Lower East Side.
Henry Frank.
Bill Frank.
Yes.
We had a lot of black dancers.
Yes.
Let me just go through this. Nikolai developed total fear. We were painted figures. Nobody had the, in our training, none of the people had big bodies. None of the people had the sexualization, of the black body. They were the greatest human beings, and Gormand, you know, just 81, just danced less. We were amazing. So he painted us, and he decorated the whole stage. And it was unanimous. The critics said, oh, this is not dance, this is dehumanization.
Oh, yes.
All over. Wow. So there I'm sitting here to see this wonderful lecture, and I was maybe 15, 16, and in this, and I'm saying, okay, what was it? You're provoking me. What was it that we did in relation to be called dehumanized with, as you know, with half black dancers and half white, whatever we were, that they read, blue, purple, and paint us. So, you know, I grow up with an anti-color sensibility and growing up in a black neighborhood.
Yeah.
So I'm terribly disturbed by being called dehumanized.
Yes,
and
yes.
And all of us, you know,
yes, right.
We're shocked.
Mm-hmm.
I just have to tell you, never recover from not being called a dancer or a
Yeah.
So it's just interesting, it's taken away totally.
Yes. Yeah.
And pretty much to this day, still whenever the work is done, people enjoy it because most of the media is hot. But when it goes from modern dance into this whole different look of where do you belong? Why are you there?
Why
the critics are all white?
It's a bigger world than, right. I agree. Yeah, and I remember those incredible performances. I remember going down to Henry Street. Yeah. By the way, B.B. Miller began there as a student. Yeah, yeah. Thank you, Phyllis.
Hi.
Yes.
I just wanted to thank you personally because for me, you know, I teach dance history and you have to get ballet in there. And your scholarship showed me a way of bringing the Africanisms into ballet, so that I always use your section of chapter one to refer to, because I can't look at the four temperaments without thinking of everything that you pointed out
about ballet,
all the Africanisms in that.
Yeah.
And then I juxtapose it actually with Anne Daly's
piece,
A Chance When You're a Hummingbird, because she takes such a different approach from you, you know, it's the feminist approach, but I just resonated with what you wrote so much, and it's really, it's helping my teaching to kind of, I feel like we really, because of you, I have to always think that in my teaching.
Thank you. Great.
In
New York.
Yes,
yeah,
well,
yeah.
White,
yeah, it's yeah. Still right. I can just give you a little, what's your name?
Patricia.
Patricia, nice to meet you. Just to give you a little update on that, John Myers Brown, who is such an incredible force in this world. We could talk all afternoon. We'll stop at some point, but just when these things come up. Joan, it's, you know, and what Don is going to bring in, what Donald was saying about being at Filadenko, that Joan had wanted to start the first black ballet company. And her dancers, the way she was trained by Essie Marie Dorsey and Marion Suger and Sidney King, and I have a, in the back of the Audacious Hope, there's a pull-out genealogy of black ballet. Okay, and the people who trained from Essie Marie through Joan, et cetera, that she had they'd all trained to be ballerinas. Joan had danced as a ballerina, was trained by Anthony Tudor, who came to Philly didn't have the sense to know that you're not supposed to have black people in his class.
But
she was mainly Marion Suger's student. But yeah, but he was teaching, it was the Ballet Guild there, it was before the Pennsylvania Ballet. But so they all thought they were gonna be somehow a place for that there was ballet was gonna happen in their lives. I won't go through the whole story, but I do tell it in the new book. But what is interesting is that, so she felt like Mr. Mitchell beat her to getting the first black ballet company, so there was no point in her trying to get another one. So she makes this company, the Philadelphia Dance Company. It's not Philadelphia Black Dance Company. It's not Philadelphia Jazz. It's the Philadelphia Dance Company that is basically a ballet-trained modern dance company. And that is still really where their roots are. And if you see it, and if you, you know, Dolores Brown for years still taught their ballet classes. Mr. Mitchell came in to teach for them. Joan Myers Brown had studied with Carol Shook in New York in the 1940s. All of those kinds of connections. And indeed, her sense of what she was giving them was this ballet training. Through a black lens, if you will. Just to say also, you know, I grew up in New York and, you know, I trained in ballet. I didn't get to African dance until much later and reviewed for Dance Magazine and for Encore American and Worldwide News and saw tons of New York City ballet performances and loved it. So it's like I get concerned if anyone would think I'm trying to bash, ballet, but which was the kind of sense with the reigning dance community when I was first doing this research. I could not even get this stuff published, okay? So, you know, we won't go into that whole history. But I'm doing all this for love of dance, you know? And I have what you said about the four temperaments, you know? I used to do a lecture where it was just on Balanchine. And I would show the four temperaments and Agon, and then show something like Snake Hips Tucker doing his dance, and talk about the Ten Canons of Fine Form of Robert Ferris Thompson. So there are ways you can talk about all of this stuff, you know. So thank you, Patricia. Thank you. Yes.
Hi, Suri.
Suri?
Yes.
Hi.
Just a question about what you asked about.
Well, you know, I think at this point, and are you speaking, Zuri, specifically of Judson? So I mean, I'm thinking of Judson today, which is movement research. And so is that kind of what you're thinking, rather than historical Judson? The movement research people, I think, are really, and sometimes they're really off point, you know, so there'll be something that's really off to left field. But I think there's a real effort with movement research to, I hate to use all the same words, but to be inclusive or embracing. So I know that Niv Acosta, who I've worked with in Germany, and Jamil Kosoko, who I'm still working with, I know that they have all done evenings and workshops and stuff at movement, through movement research. Leanna Conyers, other people that I've worked with. I mean, so I think that they are making an effort to open up. Is that what you...
I was just thinking, I was thinking of historical sense in its beginnings. I just remember reading, I think it was Shuffle, perhaps, about, and like synthesizing it with this other author, about comparing improvisation to improvisation of the body during protest. And, using fall and stillness and slack musculature as tactics to protest during the Freedom Riders era, and comparing that to things that are used during contact and competition, which I guess historically, not now, and how for the black body and that protest, it was used as protest for fighting for freedom rather than using it as a medium through which your body is free in comparison to the restrictiveness, I guess, of classical modern day
Duh, I don't know. Does anybody want to respond to what Zuri is positing? Okay. Okay, what's your name?
My name is Jossie.
Jossie, okay, but let's hear.
Well, a little bit of what I was going to say might be related.
And if we can speak a little louder, yeah.
Can I first say thank you? It's such an honor to be in the room. Thank you, it's a real revelation for me, and I've tried to be the same time in New Yorker as well.
Okay.
And I'm an uptown dancer, but specifically, a lot of my young experience was down here on the Lower East Side, and I love this talk because I started working with jazz musicians, Arts for Art, and Vision, they still work down here. And my experience here, and living in Europe for 7 years and aligning with jazz musicians in order to perform, is basically that. It's not about, are they going to let me in the room? I go into the room, I'm generally the only brown person in those
rooms.
But whether it was downtown with this continuation of the relationship between jazz, dance, and contemporary culture, street culture, and how music and dance informs fashion and styles, how we walk, how we talk.
Yes.
In the past 10 years.
Yes.
That was something that was, you know, again, going back to your talk, so strong to me, living abroad, because that's when you really get that, just to kind of pair that quote spoke to me, because I was like, oh, it's not just American culture. It is typically black dance and music culture that is what's appropriated and considered American and represented as American.
Exactly.
And so maybe part of my answer to your question was, at being here, you know, Milton teaches at Perry Dance of the Block sometimes, and you know, we can always go to Ailey and learn from Miss Forsythe and other people who affected Hilda Dingle and Ailey in the black dance world, or in the black, and especially down here on the Lower East Side. This is where I learned about dance culture and, you know, how it's related to the outside world, and blessing even the fortune of interviewing Virginia Johnson this fall. Really highlighted to me what that was, the difference, because she went here for a second. She was like, the difference between dance, how it's taught in the studios, and black dance, and how you culturalize your movement, that's not relevant. When we're dancers, we're going to interpret the movement as we interpret, and she's a ballerina, and she was very clear about knowing the history of ballet, and she's like, I go into the room with You know, when we used to go take classes with Mr. Balanchine, you know, I pulled it up. You know, but we didn't get done to come every time. So I love to talk. Thank you for bringing all that into play.
Okay.
Yes,
get out of the building. And also, this is interesting because about the pulling it up and then letting it down, but I also feel that we all, you know, bring our, and it's not about race or color, it's about culture. We bring our culture with us into the room. So, I mean, there's a way that, oh, I used to love Lowell Thomas, I think was his name, in Dance Theater of Harlem. Like, he would turn his head and he would go, I mean, it was like, you know, that there was his way that was like in his, I hate these cliches, but in his DNA, no, in his culture that had him moving. So you're doing the ballet performance, but you're also involuntarily infusing it with who you are. You know, and that's what makes it beautiful. Yeah.
I just want to point out to students, and going off of what you said, Brenda mentioned that she did write for Dance Magazine. And just as Brenda is incredibly articulate about what is generally called black dance, she also turned her laser vision to white dance and wrote an article for Dance Magazine that you can find online called Whoa, Whiteness and Dance.
I forgot.
I assigned it, some of you read it. But if you go to dancemagazine.com and look up Whoa, WHOA, Whiteness and Dance, you'll find this terrific article by Brenda enumerating the points of what makes white dance white dance.
Thank you. It's so strong. It's wonderful. Thanks, Wendy. Yes, yeah. Yes. I'm trying to get students as much as possible. Yes.
Effie?
Yeah.
Hi.
That's a dope head wrap.
Thank you. Backstory, I was thinking about it. Okay, so first of all, I want to say thank you as well. Especially for what you said about cultural production, you know, I obviously am not from the States, so I'm always thinking about these things and what is being produced and exported. And I recently watched 13th, the documentary. And I was like, oh, duh, like that's, you know, it's not just about like what is in prison, but it's about cultural production.
Yeah.
And then I think of Afro-Latinos and how like they're totally invisible, but all you see about Latino culture is Afro-Latino. Like,
yes.
Right. So my question really is, I feel in terms of how African dance is discussed in the States, or black culture versus African culture is very general.
Yes.
Still in 2016. Mm-hmm. And I just wanted to know your thoughts on that, because I think even in the language, how it's advertised, like you go, it's like African dance or West African dance, you walk into class and it's specifically Guinean.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Or, you know, or Senegalese. And so why this generalization still in 2016 when what I call now the other black body, which is, you know, the black body in the diaspora that's like straight from the continent that knows that here's the rhythm and goes, oh, this is Bango, this is like Amaja, this is why isn't that specificity being looked at? Why aren't those relationships being forged?
Mm-hmm.
It's like, our ancestors, but our ancestors are in the room together right now.
Yes.
So I wonder what your thoughts are on that.
I'm going to ask also that this is thrown out here. Jesse or whomever. Others may be better able to respond.
You have a more succinct understanding of your specific history than we do over here.
Right.
You have been displaced and from. So there's this generalization that kept it safe for many years. You know, so it was that safety of like, oh, that's just African, yeah. And I remember meeting Africans in certain years back, you know, 5 years ago, and saying, where are you from? And they're like, Africa. And I'm like, so we have a responsibility on both sides
yes.
to
yeah.
speak be more specific so that the knowledge can flourish more, because it's true. We had a wonderful master class, and it was West African dance, and she taught Lama the whole class, and I was loving it, but I was it's just specifically from a certain region that we couldn't study before, or something like that, to then fortify our knowledge. So maybe it's both sides' responsibility, whether it's the Afropolitans over there or the African-American blacks.
And I don't know how it works. The reason I thought some people in the audience might be better able to respond, I don't know how it's working, like in dance schools or conservatories or in dance studios, if people are advertising specifically. I do know that people like who I've worked with, Paloma McGregor, will do certain kinds of things up in the Bronx, the bad thing, or in Brooklyn, and when people like that are putting up a class, they will be very specific about what it is. So I mean, I think the specificity, and again, then who comes to that is very interesting. Yeah.
You can't make money. I still have to make some money. So by not defining it, means you're not eliminating anybody. So from a business point of view, Afro or African,
That should not have to apply though in a school like this. Is there? Yeah, yeah. Like, let me ask Sean. So, what's taught in the Tisch in terms of continental African dance?
Well, not a black dance, I'll just say, right?
Okay.
As a chair of a dance department, I'm wrestling with this term white space, right? And I danced for many years, as you know, for a man named Milty Jones, who did not want to be called a black choreographer. He wanted to be called a choreographer, right? So it's something I'm wrestling with. I'm so glad Zuri asked the question. Well, you asked about what we're doing here. There's so much. I'm so grateful too, but there's so much going on in my mind. I'm trying to change the things up. There's so many excuses. There's so many hours in the day. There's only so many free spaces. You know, like it's big, and things like Tisch School of the Arts change very slowly. As Arne Zain said once in a piece, it's a Jenny Holcher quote: "A system in collapse is a system moving forward." So try to remember that and push, you know, the rock up the hill, or that tomorrow is probably going to have rolled down.
Yeah.
There's
no African dance.
Sorry?
There's no African?
Well, Ron Brown is going to be coming on Fridays, and of course he does a hybrid of...
To me, that's contemporary dance, contemporary American dance. Sorry to interrupt. Go ahead.
No, it's okay. I have a grad student who's, we've been fortunate enough to have do some hip-hop classes and all. We're in New York City, but this is, you know, contemporary dance. We're training contemporary dancers to contemporary companies, maybe contemporary ballet companies. And so it's a pretty heavy diet of ballet that's anatomically approached, if not stylistically approached. And then contemporary teachers who teach techniques derived from, you know, the big names.
Yeah. It's wonderful though, because yeah, your name was just spoken. It's wonderful though, Sean, if in your position you as an established, and I will just put myself on the line, you as an established white male of a certain age, with your tenure in this thing, you have the ability to do things that if one of these people were on faculty, they would not be able to do in terms of changing curriculum. And I'm thinking about Onye Ozuzu, Do people know Anya at Columbia College, Chicago? Anya Ozuzu, who was on faculty at University of Colorado Boulder, and got, I've been there several times because she has a line of Ghanaian dance taught there, okay, with Niarma Soa teaches there. But she left there and went to Columbia College Chicago, had her staff there do the PISAB, the People's Institute of Survival and Beyond, which is about undoing racism that Ajawale has the urban bush women work with, and every summer with her summer institute. The whole
idea.
Will
be here next summer.
Okay, and this whole thing again about, it's like we have to start here with ourselves. So it's not about the people out, you know, I don't even call his name anymore. I call him DT for delirium tremens, okay?
Yeah.
And that's what I think he is. So I will not call that guy's name. But there, that's someplace else. We have to deal with undoing racism right here with us. How can we take the little seed of love and peace and understanding that we have through our somatocentric consciousness and take that to the next level to say, well, we need to actually do something about this curriculum. There is this person, it might be Effie, who actually we can groom to be a, you know, a faculty member who's going to be with us teaching this particular, and that's what Niarma Zoa is doing in the University of Colorado at Boulder. And he has wonderful training with traditional Ghanaian dance there. all I'm saying is that what Anya did was she had to come in and have people, you know, work with her faculty about this whole idea of how do you deal with your own implicit biases or whatever to open it up, and then you can change the curriculum. So, I mean, I think the only way we're, and that's what we've learned from this last election, Lord knows, the only way we are gonna do things is like on the very, very local level. One step at a time, and what we can change in our own environment. And I bring this all up, obviously I love you, I'm not putting you on the spot, I'm bringing it up because of Effie's question and Yossi's response to it. That, so how are we gonna move the mountain? How are we gonna push it up, you know?
Change is the word, and I'm not saying start or begin, because we keep starting, we keep beginning.
Exactly,
Well, let's do something, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
So, but it's curriculum, it's the faculty.
Yeah.
How do I get more lines to have a more inclusive kind of faculty?
Right.
But
how do we extend the faculty's comfort level to acknowledge and embrace?
Yeah. But I'm committed, and I just have to respond that I was so happy again to hear the story of Meredith, that when you said, do you have anything to add? She said, I'm grateful.
Yes.
And she also said, I'm paraphrasing now, but in her, inside of her, there was something of that. Right?
Yes,
and
yes.
And in my own story, it's always been a feeling like, I want what you have.
Mm-hmm.
Not to steal it.
No.
To appropriate it.
Yeah.
But in a way to make a hybrid. And I'll just go back to a quick Bill Teague story.
Mm-hmm.
Bill made a very virtuosic solo for me. He's called Secret Pastures, where I did my Irish step dancing quick, jig, and he put his postmodern Africanist, gesture phrase on top of it.
Wow.
It was polyrhythmic, it was Africanist,
yeah,
it
yeah.
was Irish,
yes.
it was a collage, it was a hybrid, it was speaking an old language in a new way with a contemporary accent,
yes.
which is grand speak, to be sure, but something I've always been interested in.
Right.
What do you do it?
Right.
Where do I end and we begin?
Exactly.
Where do we, overlap? Mm-hmm. There's two circles.
Right.
And Sean got a message for that solo.
but it was an important lesson.
And that's why I even speak this to you, because I feel that you're an ally.
Yeah.
And this whole thing about who is an ally, and how do you then, as an ally, move the loop. you know, push the envelope, move the mountain, and you have the capacity to do it.
Yeah, but I need a lot of help.
You hear that?
Yeah.
Okay, all right, yeah. I think we should let this young man go.
Oh, yeah, so to reiterate.
What's your name?
Yuri.
Hi, Yuri.
So to reiterate what has been said, also thank you for coming and giving this talk, it's so incredible. To reiterate sort of just that, which is about Sean being an ally type thing, I do want to commend him and thank him for what, like I think we've only having been here one semester, already seeing the amount of change that he has taken in this department, particularly from feedback from the students, a lot of the grad students, and there's a lot of people of color. In this particular first year MFA class, it's like really exciting, and I think there's a lot of changes coming through that. Mm-hmm. But I think just looking around the room, I think just the fact that there's a, I don't know how many the number, but there's like a lot more people at Tisch than just this. And I am a little disappointed at the, like, the turnout, the people that are here. So it definitely does start with that, like, the bureaucratic level with like a white, very, you know, cisgender, very powerful man who has a lot of ability to change, but also I think the students need to take some initiative to actually come to talks like this and be present. I mean, you wrote this incredible book. I also read Dig in the African Aesthetic as well.
Okay.
So it's like crazy to me that people aren't showing up these kinds of things because you're like, Sean's at the beginning of God, so it's like, it doesn't really make me, so that's not, like, the, he's already there, like, he's definitely taking so many steps to
that
for us. I think we as a community also need to come forward and actually, you know, take part in that, because, like, you, you've been doing faculty on the Special Fridays, like, Pretty, I think her name, and it was, like, she's a Hollywood, Bratanatian teacher, and, like, when I looked up at the sign-up sheet, like, no one had signed up for her class, and everyone else was like, it's like, over here, there was already no space left, we were already, it's like, you have this incredible opportunity to learn something with someone completely different, what you're already learning every single week, why don't you take that opportunity?
Yes.
So it's like, you're providing us those tools, we just need to actually take initiative to taking it.
Yeah.
So thank you.
Great.
Yeah.
It's kind of
Thank you. You know, I'm getting a little tired. I'm still recovering. If there's anything that is burning, and I'm so appreciative of this one. I love being in a dance studio rather than, you know, on a stage and behind a, you know, podium or whatever.
It's where you belong.
Thank you. And it was just really wonderful. I mean, we as a group, all of us who are here at this moment in time, we will never meet again in this way at this particular moment in time. So if we can just take a little moment to just be present with us, just this moment. I am so grateful. Thank you. Namaste. Thank you.
I know you look cold.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you all.